Alright guys, this beautiful morning we're going to be taking a look at the Schmidt Ruben 1889. It's an antique rifle. This rifle was adopted by the Swiss government in 1889, and this particular model was made in 1892, so it's early production. There were about 212,000 of these rifles produced, and today they're generally considered obsolete. They're in an obsolete caliber, the GP90 or GP90-23, which is a less powerful form of the 7.5 Swiss round. So these are actually an antique. They can be delivered right to your door in most of the free states. And today we're going to be, like I said, taking a look at it, and we're going to be dispelling some of the myths surrounding the 1889, because there are plenty of them out there. A lot of the information is mistranslations and just general, you know, people not knowing what they're talking about. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and get started. It's gonna be a fun day because the 1889 is actually a great rifle if you know what you're doing with it. So let's reach into our pouch here, get a stripper clip, let's get this show on the road. Alright guys, as you can see there, our Schmidt Ruben functioned flawlessly and it didn't explode. There's a big myth out there that these guns are just explosions waiting to happen, and that just really isn't true. It's kind of like a lot of the myths with the Krag Jorgensen rifle, the US produced Krag. A lot of people think that they're just waiting to come apart. Now, the entire Schmidt Ruben line was tested by the Swiss meticulously. They knew the limits of every single Schmidt Ruben in the Schmidt Ruben line, and they knew exactly where to draw the line. The 1889 has an action strength rated for 40,000 CUP. It was just never rated by the SAMI spec here in the United States for whatever reason. There was just never research done on it, which is why there's no load data for it. But the Swiss certify the action to 40,000 CUP. The cartridges that we are loading, or that I'm reproducing, take a look at them here. These are my approximation of GP90-23. The GP90-23 was the upgraded round over the lead bullet that had a paper patch and a early form of smokeless powder. One of the other myths out there is that it was semi-smokeless powder, but that's actually a mistranslation of the German. It's actually an early form of nitrocellulose. It was not black powder in any form. It was completely smokeless. But it boasted a velocity of 1900 feet per second, and it weighed just over 200 grains and it was paper patched. This is the upgraded round, or approximation of it. It has a solid copper jacket. The original was 190 grain Cooper nickel. And I'm getting 2100, or just under 2100 feet per second, with the original being right at 2000 feet per second using 30 grains of nitrocellulose. I'm using IMR 4895, and that's about all I'm going to tell you about the cartridge in this video, because I'm going to have a dedicated video on how I reproduce the GP90-23. So be looking for that video. When I do get it out, I'll put it in the description box below, and there'll be a link there so you can see how I reload this. But it's as close as an approximation as you can get using modern materials. This has 180 grain Hornady round nose. It's a beautiful bullet, and it's traveling, like I said, just under 2100 feet per second, and the pressure is at 30,000 CUP. So that's 10,000 CUP under what the action is rated for, and that's 7,000 CUP under what the original GP90-23 was. So it's going very easy on this action. So here we'll use the stripper clip, get that in. Now that we've done a lot of talking, let's go ahead and destroy some watermelons and water bottles. As you can see, we got one more left. That watermelon didn't explode as spectacularly as the first one. Let's see if we can dispatch it. There we go. Here is a couple of my expended shells. As you can see, the primers look great. I'm getting no gas leakage, which means I'm getting a good gas seal. There's no soot on the rounds, no signs of pressure. Again, that's launching a 180 grain bullet at just under 2100 feet per second. You know, it's not booking it by today's standards, you know, 2100 feet per second isn't up there with something like 308 or 30-06 or a lot of your modern calibers, but as you can see by the way those soda bottles and watermelons reacted, it's definitely not something you'd want to get hit with. So let's back up to some range and see what we can do accuracy wise. Alright guys, before we get to shooting here at 200 yards, I want to direct your attention to the rear sight on this 1889. Some people think it looks kind of funky. I think it looks kind of cool, especially on this rifle. But as you can see, it starts at 300 meters and it's graduated all the way out to 2,000 meters. So as per usual, or as per standard fare of most rifles of the day, a 300 meter battle sight is pretty average and is shooting dead on at 30 yards. And then again, it comes back out to being zeroed at 300. So I can't get quite to 300 yards on this particular piece of property. But we're at just over 200 yards and we're gonna shoot a green paper law enforcement target and see what kind of groups we can get out here just prone, unsupported. So, like I said, some people will complain about this sight, but I actually think it looks really cool. It's not as precise as the sight on the 1911. The rear notch is a little bit bigger. So maybe theoretically you can't be quite as accurate with it, but I like it. I like the way it looks when you're looking down the sights, as you're seeing right there. And it's interesting the way that it adjusts. If I can bring your attention up here, you see that the sight bridge is split. There's a spring in there and you push it in to adjust it. And you can see the grooves that correspond there on the side there. So you push in and you can adjust up all the way to the ridiculous 2,000 meters and all the way back down to the more manageable 300 meters. So, all right guys, so downrange we have some law enforcement targets. Let's go ahead and get this thing going. Again, we're shooting my GP9023 reloads and we have 12 rounds. All right, get this show on the road. Just over 200 yards. Calming down my breathing so we can give a good, accurate representation of the rifle and not me. Thank you. see how many we got left. All right, guys, it's a long ways for that small Ipsic target, but I'm going to attempt to put some of the rounds on steel. This is my first time shooting something that small with this rifle at this distance, so let's see if we can do it.
You wanna wait for the train?
No, I'm just shooting.
Wait.
All right, first round hit. All right. Damn it. Man, guys, that is a sweet rifle. It weighs just over 10 pounds and it's got over a 30-inch barrel, so it's a little long, but there's enough weight in the action in the back that it balances quite well. Giving my arms and elbows a little rest here since we got 12 rounds and we're unsupported prone. We're probably at about 220 yards. I forgot to bring out the Leica rangefinder today, but I've shot enough out here to know that that would be my closest guess, as we're probably about 220 yards. All right. We got two rounds left. I'm gonna go ahead and go back to steel. Now I've got my heart rate under control. And we'll see what we can do with this ticking time bomb of a rifle. One miss. Not too shabby. All right, guys, let's make the 220 yard walk back down to the target and let's see what we did. I'm interested to see what we did because there's no exact point of aim on those law enforcement targets. So let's go see. All right, guys, not bad, not bad at all. Especially for over 200 yards, open sights. My point of aim was right here. So as you can see, it is shooting a little high, probably between this ring and this ring. Not sure at that distance. I put the rear sight on it. And it's shooting about 6 inches high still, which is consistent with the rear sight. And yeah, I'm very happy with that group for over 200 yards, unsupported prone, open sights. Elbows digging into the ground, you know, all that good stuff. Like I said, not bad for a 120-year-old gun that everybody tells you is unsafe to shoot or unfit to shoot. That's pretty dang good. Let's come over here and look at the steel target. The steel target group might actually, to me, be a little more impressive than the paper target. A little more precise point of aim. It contrasted with my front sight a little better. My point of aim was right here. You can see most of the rounds are right here. These ones that came high were probably due to me. I can tell from the shooting that I've done at the bench, at the range, which I'll roll in a picture for you guys. The rifle shoots under MOA. I was able to get a one MOA group at 100 yards for that particular range trip, but I know that the rifle is more capable than I am. And like I said, these targets show it. Alright guys, as you can see, the Schmidt Rubin 1889 is a really smooth shooter, and it's very capable. Like I said, the action is rated to 40,000 CUP. My cartridges operate at 30,000 CUP. It's 10,000 under what the action is rated for, with the original rounds being loaded to 37,000 CUP. Now, like I said, the internet will tell you this gun will explode at any second because of these rear mounted locking lugs. But like I said, the action was strenuously tested, and actually, when the 1911 came out, which is the rifle that replaced the 1889, because even though it's a decent action, at 40,000 maximum pressure, it couldn't sustain holding up to GP11, which operates at 45,000 CUP. However, like I said, when the 1911 was first adopted, there was a shortage of arms as they were converting the 1896 rifles into the newer 9611s. So since there was a shortage of rifles and it was a turbulent time in Europe, World War I was just getting ready to get started, the Swiss government actually reissued the 1889 to a lot of its troops, even though they knew that their stocks of GP9023 and GP90 were very low. So what they did was, it was issued to them out, and it was issued to them with the understanding that GP11 could be used in the 1889. However, using it should be done only in an emergency, because again, it was a well-known fact and well tested out that after being fed a steady diet of GP11, the 1889's bolt would begin to show signs of stress fracturing. So it was fine for an emergency. It was fine for an emergency, but with the operating pressure being 5,000 CUP over what this action was rated for, it just couldn't take a steady diet of it. So to prove this, here we have a clip of GP11, as you guys can see here. So here we have a full clip of GP11, and just to show you, it ain't gonna blow up, remember? This is 5,000 PSI over the standard operating pressure. As you can see, it chambers no problem. Nah, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to shoot GP11. The rifle's 120 years old. 100 years ago, I would have had no problem with it. In fact, I'm 99.99% sure it would fire without hazard, but the rifle's 120 plus years old. I'm not going to shoot GP11. I will, however, now is a good time to point off the magazine cutoff feature. This was erased in later rifles. The Swiss, when they adopted the 1889, they were just coming away from the Vetterli rifles, which had a high magazine capacity. So they wanted this 12-shot magazine. But if you see right there, that lever cuts off the magazine. Traditional magazine cutoff, as was common at the time. As you can see, the bolt rides over it. It doesn't pick up a round. And you have 12 rounds in your magazine for reserve. All that's needed to do to put it back into action is lower that lever, cock the bolt, and as you can see, we're feeding a new round of GP11. So we'll go ahead and get that emptied out and we'll shoot something else. That one was better. Hold that one. All right guys, we're gonna finish out this video shooting from the 25-yard line. All right, guys, as you can see from 25 yards, that is 12 rounds, and that is not a bad looking group at all from this old Schmidt Ruben 1889. Like I said, my particular example was made in 1892. It's over 120 years old. And like I've hoped that you have noticed that I've been saying throughout the whole video, these rifles really do not deserve the bad rap that they get in some circles. Yeah, there's no commercially available rounds for them, and there's no SAMI standard for them. However, if you do a little bit of research and a little bit of reloading, these are excellent rifles capable of phenomenal accuracy. As I showed you earlier on the picture that I did from shooting at another range at 100 yards from the bench, I was able to get just over one MOA at 100 yards with this rifle. I know from shooting out here and from shooting at closer distances, I mean, that's standing 25 yards, 12 rounds in succession. So I know that the rifle's capable of probably half MOA if you sit down and do your part with it. I could get half MOA if I sit down and work with it a little more. And if you subscribe to Facebook and Instagram, especially Instagram, at Murphy's Muskets, you'll see that. I post pictures of my targets and accuracy work all the time. So phenomenal cartridge. Like I said, there's going to be a companion video to this that I'll put a link in the description box below when it gets uploaded. It's going to have all of the information on the cartridge itself, how I reload GP9023, and a little more history on it, just to help any of you out there who may have an 1889 get that old girl singing again. So thanks for watching, guys. I really appreciate it, and I'll catch you all later. Hi guys, I hope you've enjoyed this video with the Schmidt Ruben 1889. I've had a lot of fun shooting it, and like I said, the 1889 is a great rifle. However, back here sitting in the shadows, we have the rifle that replaced the 1889. This is the Schmidt Ruben 1911. As far as accuracy goes, this is the crown jewel of the Schmidt Ruben lineup. This is gonna be the next Swiss rifle review as soon as we get the Schmidt Ruben 1889 stuff taken care of. So be sure that you stay tuned, because we got a lot more really cool Swiss rifle videos coming up. As you can see, there's that GP11. We will load that. The 1889 is rated for GP11. We'll also be talking about some more of those ridiculous internet gun myths when we get to this 1911 review. So make sure you guys stay tuned. Oh yeah, it's got some more power to it. Yeah, buddy. Now we're cooking with GP11. All right, guys, I just wanted to take a minute here at the end to consolidate some of my personal thoughts and opinions. That is what you guys are here for, right? Throughout the course of making this review, I discovered that while the 1889 is about 3/4 of a pound heavier than the 1911, that as far as all the Schmidt Rubens are concerned, it's a really, really sweet shooting rifle. The recoil is very mild. I mean, it's enough to let you know you're shooting a high-powered rifle cartridge, but it's not so much that it's difficult to shoot or that it's unpleasant to shoot. And throughout the course of this video, I probably fired 120, let me count, I got them right here, 133 cartridges, and nothing as far as the shoulder. The recoil impulse is just so nice. And so I've actually discovered through the course of this review that I'm actually enjoying shooting the 1889 more than the later 1911, K11, or K31. It's definitely not as powerful, and it's definitely got its limitations. There was a reason that these other rifles came into existence. But as far as just pure shooter enjoyment on the range, I'm sitting there and I'm shooting my rifle, oh man, it's fun to shoot. So Anyway, that's pretty much my personal opinion of the rifle. If you can find one, it's worth picking up. If you have one, get the components, reload for it. You'll have a blast. It's a really cool rifle. Not only do you have the novelty of it being an obsolete cartridge, but like I said, it's so sweet to shoot that you'll really enjoy it. So thanks a bunch, guys. Thanks for watching. Please give me a like. Like I said, we shot over 130 rounds of this ammunition. I mean, that's going to be over $100 just in ammo cost for this video alone. So the likes really help support the channel, and they really help support the video. So that's it, guys. I'm gone for real this time. Thanks for watching again, and I'll catch you next time.